this video, I will be discussing integral calculus. We may recall that addition and subtraction are inverse operations as well as multiplication and division. Now, in this video, we will discuss the inverse of differentiation, which we've learned from our differential calculus. And the inverse operation of differentiation, which we call here as anti-differentiation, is the main topic in this video. Since it is the inverse of differentiation, we expect that anti-differentiation is the process of finding the function whose derivative or differential is given. This process is also called integration. So here, I just write here that anti-differentiation is the inverse of differentiation. And most commonly, we call this process as integration. So integration is the process of finding the antiderivative of the given function. So another term for anti-differentiation is what we call integration. Now, we should realize that there are a lot of problems in the physical world that can be modeled by integration. So, what are the symbols used in integration or anti-differentiation? We learn from our differential calculus that to find the derivative of a function, we will use the symbol f prime of x. Or we may use y prime. Or we may use the derivative of y with respect to x. Or we may use the derivative of the function f with respect to x. Or others are using the derivative of y with respect to x. Or others are using the derivative of the function of x with respect to x. Now, in anti-differentiation or integration, there is only one most commonly used symbol, and that symbol is this one. It's an elongated S that was introduced to us by Leibniz. And most commonly, we write this one with a partner, which we have here, dx. So this elongated S, we call this one as the integral symbol. And there is a partner, which we have here, the dx. And the function inside this one, f of x, is what we call the integrand. So the function that is inside the integral symbol and this dx is what we call the integrand. So dx here will give you an idea for the variable of integration in this integration process. So if the integral of f of x dx is the big f of x, then if you get the derivative of this big f of x, the derivative of this big f of x is the small f of x. Now, that idea can be illustrated by this definition here. So, a function big f is called the antiderivative of the small f on an interval I if the big f prime of x is equal to the small f of x for all x in I. This simply means that if you are given a function, say big f of x, and the derivative of this big f of x is the small f of x, then the integral of this small f of x dx is the original function big f of x. So actually, if the big f of x is a function whose derivative is this small f of x on a certain interval on the x-axis, then the big f of x is called the antiderivative of the function small f of x, which is the integrand here. So I will give you an illustration for this. So we'll tackle here this question. So what is the function y, which is equal to the big f of x, if the derivative of this function is 3x squared. Actually, there are many possible solutions for this problem. One possible solution is that y could be x cubed, because the derivative of this x cubed is 3x squared. Or it could be y is equal to x cubed plus 1, because we know that the derivative of x cubed using the power rule in differential calculus is 3x squared, and the derivative of 1, which is a constant, is 0. So still, the derivative of this is this. Or you may have a function, say x cubed minus 7. This could be a possible solution for this. Why? Because if you take the derivative of this, the derivative is still 3x squared, because the derivative of x cubed is 3x squared, and derivative of negative 7 is 0. Or you can have a solution, say y is equal to x cubed minus the square root of 5, because if you solve for the derivative of this, the derivative of x cubed minus square root of 5 is still 3x squared. Or you may have y is equal to x cubed plus some constant c, where c is a constant. You see that the derivative of this is still this one, 3x squared. Now, in this problem, we are looking for the function, the big F function, wherein the derivative of this function is 3x squared. And we notice that there are a lot of possible answers for this problem. Now, you see here that among the five possible solutions I have written, the most general one is this one. So, this one is a more general function because it embraces all other solutions. So, in symbols, we write that the integral of 3x squared, which is this one, and then there is a partner of the integral symbol, which is the dx, is equal to x cubed plus c. So our answer here is this one. And what is the c? C is a constant, so it has no specific value. And because there is no specific value, we call this one as an arbitrary constant in our answer. So we say that this expression is what we call the indefinite integral. Now, you will find out as you go deeper in the study of integral calculus that the main difficulty is the integration of several types of functions that arise. Even when you master the techniques in the clever guesswork to find the antiderivatives, there will be functions that you will not be able to anti-differentiate or integrate. Actually, anti-differentiation is inherently more difficult than differentiation, because there is no a complete set of rules like in differentiation that enables you to anti-differentiate any complicated function step by step at a time. For example, in differentiation, we have what we call the product rule, but in integration, we don't have that straightforward formula for the product rule. Also, in differentiation, we have what we call the quotient rule, but in integration, there is no quotient rule. There is no straightforward formula for the quotient. So those are things that we should not forget in anti-differentiating a given function. So one caution that I mentioned is that there is no product rule. Say, if you want to find the integral of f of x times the g of x dx, the integral of the product of two functions is not the same when you integrate f of x and then multiply the result with the integral also of the g of x. There. So the integral of a product is not the same as the product of the integrals of the individual factors. Also, the integral of a quotient, the integral of f of x divided by g of x, where g of x is not equal to zero, is not the same as the integral of the numerator f of x dx divided by the integral of the denominator g of x dx. This is not true in integration. There is no quotient rule in integration. So how do you integrate a quotient of two functions? There is a technique, but there is no straightforward formula for that. Also, if you want to integrate a product of f of x and g of x dx, this is not the same as if you don't know how to integrate f of x, so I factor it outside f of x times the integral of g of x dx because you know how to integrate the g of x. This is not true. So these are the most common pitfalls of the students that they will apply in integrating functions. So that when they integrate a product, they will think as the product of the integrals of the individual factors. That when they integrate a quotient, they will think it is equal to the quotient of the individual integrals. The integral of the numerator divided by the integral of the denominator. This is not true. Also, you cannot factor out some functions outside the integral symbol. So these are things that we should remember and you should take into consideration, and you should not forget in integrating especially difficult functions. At this point, we'll proceed to the basic formulas in finding the antiderivative of some basic functions. So in facilitating this integration process, we may use some of the basic formulas here, and I wrote here four basic formulas. So given u and v are differentiable functions of x, and the letters a, n, and c are constants, then the following formulas can be used. So integral formula number one is that the integral of du, it's u plus c. And formula number two, it's the integral of a constant a times du. Because a is a constant, you can factor it out outside the integral symbol. So a times the integral of du. Formula number three is that the integral of the sum or difference is just equal to the sum and difference of their individual integrals. And formula number four is the counterpart of the power rule in differentiation, that here in the integration process, the integral of u to the power n du is equal to u to the power n plus 1. And remember, in differential calculus, we subtract. Here, it's really the inverse, we add. So instead of subtracting 1 in our differentiation, we add 1 in integration. And instead of multiplying the result to the base, here we divide it here in integral calculus. And of course, there is what we call the constant of integration C, where n, the exponent, must not be equal to negative 1. Because if this is negative 1, it will make the denominator 0. So, to illustrate the use of these formulas, let's have example number 1. Number 1 is that, what is the integral of dx? And this one is just the application of formula number 1. that the integral of du, the integral and the derivative symbol cancels each other. So in this case, the integral of dx is simply x plus the constant of integration c. So this is our answer for this example number one. Number two here, what is the integral of 9x squared dx? Now you see that there is a constant of 9, which is a factor which is multiplied to x squared. Now we can use formula number 2 that the constant can be factored outside. So we may say here that this is 9 times the integral of x squared dx. And because there is no constant, so we can now apply the power rule here in the formula number 4, that the integral of x squared is just equal to 2 plus 1, because you need to add 1, that becomes 3. And whatever is your exponent that will be used to divide the term. And there is a constant of integration c. So the answer actually here is equal to 3x cubed plus c. Because 9 when divided by 3, it's 3. So this is also our answer for example number 2. So let's proceed to number 3. What is the integral of 2x minus 3 here? Quantity squared dx. Now you see, we are looking for the integral of a square of a binomial. One thing we can do here, which is very common for beginners, is to expand this square of the binomial. So when you expand this one, get the square of this binomial, that is equal to 4x squared, which is the square of 2x, minus 12x, which is twice of the product of 2x and negative 3. So 2x times negative 3, that is negative 6x, and twice of that, that's negative 12x. And then we square the second term, which is 9 here. And what is the integral of this? We can apply the formula number 3, that the integral of a sum or the integral of a difference is equal to the sum or the difference of their individual integrals. So here I can get the integral individually for every term here in this trinomial. So the integral of 4x squared dx minus the integral of 12x dx here plus the integral of 9 dx. Now you see there is always a dx here because that's the partner of the integral symbol. Now there is a constant of 4, so applying formula, second formula of integration, you can factor out the 4. So 4 times the integral of x squared dx here, and also you can factor out the 12, so 12 times the integral of x dx here, and also the 9 plus 9 times the integral of dx. Now you see, I can now apply the power rule for integration. So, and the integral of x squared is x cubed over 3, because you just again add 1 to the exponent, so 2 plus 1 equals 3, and that exponent will be used to divide the term, minus 12, and you know that the exponent of x, it's understood to have an exponent of 1, so if you add 1, that becomes x squared over 2. And then plus 9 here, and we can apply here formula number 1. that the integral and the differential symbol cancels each other, so that is x. And remember, we have a c here, a constant of integration for this integral, and we have another c here for this integral, and we have another c for this integral, but we just group them as one c. So actually, what is the answer for this? This is equal to 4/3 x cubed minus 6 x squared, because 12 divided by 2 equals 6, plus 9x plus the constant of integration c. So this is now our answer for our third example here. Now let's proceed to the fourth example. So number 4 here, what is the integral of x squared minus 5 to the power of, say, 6x dx? Now this time, this example is a different example from number 3. Why? Because it's not easy to expand this binomial. It's not easy to raise this binomial x squared minus 5 to the 6th power. And we expect that there are 7 terms here. It's not easy. So in this case, what will you do is we will use a little technique. And the technique is to use a dummy variable, say u, and we let u as x squared minus 5, the expression under the exponent of 6. And you know that if you get the differential of u here, the differential of x squared is 2x dx. Because the differential, the derivative of negative 5 is 0. And you notice that what we have here is only x dx. But here, in our differential, we have 2x dx. So we need to eliminate 2 here by dividing both sides by 2. So du over 2 is the value of our x dx. So by substitution, instead of writing this x squared minus 5, you will write u, because we represent this binomial as our u here. So u to the power 6, and we know that x dx is our du over 2. So instead of writing x dx, you will write du over 2. So du over 2. Now you see that our integrand is in terms of u, not anymore x. But it's okay, because we just transform our integrand to another variable u. So because there is a constant of 2 in the denominator of du, you can factor it out applying formula number 2, that this can be factored as 1/2 times the integral of u to the power 6 du. And you see that I can apply now the formula number 4 here. That is equal to 1/2, and the integral of u to the power 6, it's u to the power 7, because you just need to add 1 to 6. So 6 plus 1 is 7 over 7 here, plus the constant of integration c. So therefore, the final answer is 1 over 14, because that's the product of 2 times 7 times u to the power 7. But remember, we need to go back to our original variable. But what is our u here? Our u is x squared minus 5. So that is to be raised to the power of 7, plus the constant of integration c. So this is now our answer for problem number 4. Now let's proceed to problem number 5 here. What is the integral of sine x cosine x dx? Actually, there are a lot of techniques to integrate this one. I will just present one. Now, remember the caution that I presented to you earlier, that there is no product rule in integration. There is no straightforward formula for a product in integration. So what is the integral of sine x times cosine x? Remember, that is not the same as the integral of sine x times the integral of cosine x. What will you do is we need to use the U substitution, the one that we used in example number 4. So how are we going to do that? We let U be example, our U here is sine x. And you should think in advance that the du must be there here in our integrand. So what is the du here? The du, the derivative of sine x, is cosine x. And you notice that we have also this expression here in our integrand. So by substitution, we say that instead of writing sine x, we write u. And instead of writing cosine x dx, we write du. And because of this, we can now apply the power rule here, our fourth formula, that is equal to u squared over 2 plus c. Why? Because u here is understood to an exponent of 1. And if you use the power rule, you just add 1 to the existing exponent of 1. So 1 plus 1 equals 2, and the result will be the 1 to be placed in the denominator. So that is u squared over 2 plus c. However, we need to go back to our original variable, original term, because our original term is not in terms of u, but it is in terms of x. So what is our u? Our u is sine x. So we may write here sine x quantity squared all over 2 plus c. And this is our answer for problem number 5. There. So let's proceed to problem number 6. What is the integral of the square root of x plus 1 over the square root of x dx here? Now, maybe this is a little bit difficult for you. One thing to simplify is to express the radical term into an exponential form. So that square root of x, if you want, can be expressed to x to the power 1/2. And the other one, because the square root is in the denominator, so that is 1 over x to the power 1/2. And if you want to place it in the numerator, the exponent, the sign of the exponent will be negative in this case. So what is the integral of x to the power 1/2? We just apply the power rule that this is equal to x to the power 3/2, because we need to add 1 to 1/2, and that is 3/2 over 3/2 here. Plus, if you add 1 to the negative 1/2, that becomes 1/2. So x to the power 1/2 divided by 1/2 plus the constant of integration c. If you want to divide 3/2 to this term, then you multiply the numerator by the reciprocal of that. So that becomes 2/3 of x to the power 3/2. Plus, you need to multiply the numerator by the reciprocal of this. So this is 2 over 1 x to the power 1/2 plus c. And this is the answer to our problem 6. Or you may transform this one as the square root of x cubed in a radical form, and this one as the square root of x. Also, suppose we have here the integral of x cubed times x to the power of 4 plus 3 to the power quantity to the power of 5 dx. So how do you find the integral of this? Now you see, here in integral calculus, it's good to think in advance what could be your u here, such that the du is also there. Now you can spot, if you are already an experienced person in calculus, you can spot that if you let this one as your u, because the derivative of x to the power 4 will involve x cubed. So if you use this one as your u, you can also find your du here in the integrand. So I may rewrite this one like the integral of x to the power of 4 plus 3 quantity raised to the power of 5 x cubed dx here. So if you let u be equal to x to the 4th plus 3, you can find your du as, because the derivative of x to the power 4 is 4x cubed dx. But I don't have a 4 here, it's only x cubed dx, so I need to eliminate 4 by dividing both sides by 4. So this is just equal to x cubed dx. So by substitution, I can have, instead of writing x to the power of 4 plus 3, I will write u. So by substitution, that's u to the power of 5. And instead of writing x cubed dx, I may write du over 4. And you notice that there is a constant of 4 in the denominator, but I can apply formula number 2 there, that I can factor out 4 in the denominator, so I will have here 1/4 times the integral of u to the power of 5 du. So actually this is equal to 1/4 of your u to the power of 6 over 6 plus the constant of integration c. But of course, we need to go back what is our u. So this is 1 over 24, because 4 times 6 is 24, times u, but our u is x to the power of 4 plus 3. Quantity should be raised to the exponent of 6 plus the constant of integration c. So this is our answer for problem number 7. Here. Now we'll proceed to problem number 8. And maybe this is our last example, because there is no space here anymore. So what is the integral of sine x dx over cosine to the 4x? Now, to find the integral of this, we need a clever technique. You need to think in advance. You need to look ahead, guess ahead, looking forward, thinking in advance. How do you think in advance? Look for the terms that you need to represent as u, and then get the du. If the du is there, then that could be a right technique. So example, if you let your u, most commonly the u is the term that is being raised to a power. So you see here, cosine to the 4x. So you may use cosine x as your u. So here, cosine x, because if I will find the du, the derivative of cosine, it's the negative sine x here, dx. But I don't have a negative there, but I can eliminate the negative by multiplying both sides of the equation by negative 1, so I will have negative du is equal to positive sine x dx, because negative sine x dx times negative 1 is positive sine x dx. So by substitution, I can have negative du over u to the power of 4, because instead of writing sine x dx, I will write its value, which is negative d. And instead of writing cosine x, I will write u. So we are transforming this integral into another variable, which is u. But here, there is no quotient rule, but I can apply the power rule by rewriting this as the u to the power negative 4 du, and the negative here can be factored outside as negative 1. So actually, this is equal to the negative of applying the power rule in the formula number 4, that is u to the power negative 3 over negative 3. Because if you add 1 to negative 4, that is negative 3. And there is a constant of integration of c. So if you multiply the negative times the negative, that becomes positive. So that is positive 1/3 times u to the power negative 3 plus c. But of course, you need to go back to the original function, which is in terms of x. So this is 1 over 3. Because the exponent is negative, we'll bring it down to make it positive and go back to the value of u, which is the cosine of x. So cosine of x to the power of 3 plus c. So this is our answer for problem number 8 here. If you learned something today, please check out my channel for more videos like this and click subscribe. Click the notification bell below so you get notified whenever I'm posting a new video. Don't forget to like this video to show your support. And always remember to map your way up. Thank you.